Welcome everybody, this is Mr. Fugu, and you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we will be working with nested data using Pymongo. We will make some basic queries, show how to do aggregation, and MapReduce. The code will be on my GitHub with a link in the description below. Make sure to subscribe and turn on that notification bell. And like this video, and if you don't like it, please leave a comment and let me know why before you throw a thumbs down. So, we need to import Pymongo as PYM, import pandas. Optionally, you can import pretty print, and we will need to import from bison.code, import code. Now, we'll set up our connection where we're calling it client, where it equals pym.mongoclient, and then we're calling our localhost here. My database is called client, it's called Berkeley. The collection is recruiter clients. I am storing that as candidate user info. All right. Now, if you would like to see where I got this, data for our database, check two videos of mine. One, nested JSON example, where I created the data set. The other video, where I used it in MongoDB for my little short series. That will be in the second video of the series. And I will put a link to those videos as well at the top of the screen. Now, what we have here is basically if I was a recruiter looking for candidates, and I have each candidate where they have a first name, last name, a list of their skill set, the state they live in, the specialty, the level of experience, and are they willing to relocate? Okay? And then I say, I want to find anybody with the first name of Brenda. Sure, why not? So we iterate through our database and find this. So we say candidate user info, which is storing my, basically it's storing my database.collection. And I'm saying, since this is nested, I have to do the dot method. So candidate.firstname. And always remember, outer.inner. outer.inner. Okay, so we find that there's two people with the name of Brenda. All right, wonderful. Not very different from what we would use in native Mongo in the shell. Now let's find only people with a skill set of Spark, but let's ignore printing out the object ID. Basically, like, think of it as your primary key for your document. Okay, so this is only people with the skill set of Spark. Okay, if you look here, so we could run some basic queries. That's fine and dandy. Now let's see if we could use some operators. So we iterate through this and we're looking for anybody who lives in California and Florida. So let's just pretend that my boss tells me we have two jobs coming up and we need people who live in California or Florida. And let's see if they'd be interested in this job. So if you notice here, we have to put a string around our operator. Whereas if we were using Mongo, native Mongo, we wouldn't have to do this, okay? So if you notice here, this is what we put in the terminal, and we don't need it here. Otherwise, everything else is the same, okay? So we iterate through this, and I say, well, what does this look like? And here's what it looks like. This is with the pretty print. This is not. If I wanted to access these candidates, I have to iterate through this now and go inside to pluck everything off if I'm going to either extract this data or place it into a data frame, for instance. So we end up doing this query, storing this as a list, which I said store California, Florida, iterate through that, and then I call a new list that I need to append all of my candidates. I create another list that's only my IDs, and then I create my data frame. And after I create that data frame, I basically add a new column called IDs, where I take the stored list of only my IDs, and I print that out. And here's what that looks like. So we have our object IDs and all of our other information. And if you wanted, you could resort this where this column was first if you wanted to. And I showed how to do that in another example. I think it was in the first Mongo video. But don't quote me on that. Now, let's assume that we want to do an aggregation now. Okay? So we set it up very similar to native Mongo in the shell, but we're still calling our aliased db.collection name, which here is candidate user info, and then we call the aggregate. But what you have to pay attention is each operator needs to be enclosed by a string. So I'm doing a project, and I say I want to project all, let's zoom in a little bit more. So I want to project all of the candidates by first name, that I want to use. I want to use all of the candidate last names. Now I'm creating something new where I'm storing the what I want to do. So I'm calling it number of skills, and I need to enclose that in a string, and as well as this, because it's an operator, and I'm calling a condition. And this if needs to be stored in a string, as well as then and size, because that is a operator as well. So what's going on here? I'm calling a project where I'm taking the first name and the last name or what I want. I'm storing something new, let's call it number of skills, where I'm creating a condition with an if else, basically, where I say, if we have an array, which is our candidate skills, then let's get the size of that list for our skills. If that's not there, then we're going to just put an NA. And let's skip any ID tags because we don't need that. So now we iterate through that, and what we get is basically each candidate by first and last name, where we have a count of all of the skills that each person has. Okay, so some people have a lot of skills, some people don't have a lot of skills, but that's okay, because in life, some people have a lot of skills, some people don't. Some people are really specialized in one thing, you know? Now let's try something really simple where we do a match and we look for anybody who has a skill, or excuse me, a specialty of machine learning, since that's a really hot topic nowadays, right? And the only thing you're doing different here is you're enclosing this with a string where we're saying, let's use the aggregate and let's take a match similar to if we're doing a regular expression match and find anybody with a specialty in machine learning, and let's just print them off. So we got somebody with the last name of Stewart who does machine learning, somebody last name of Lynn does machine learning, and so on. Okay, cool. So that means that we could do aggregations and queries, but now let's run MapReduce. And this is kind of interesting. What's going on with MapReduce, all right? You need to import this. I did it at the top, but this is really important. Okay, so you're saying the from bison.code import code with a capital C. Okay? And what's going on here is you're creating your map function, you're creating your reduce function, and you're throwing it into your map reduce, right? So what I'm doing here is I'm creating a function where I say emit this.candidate state. So the emit is always with your map function, if you've never used map functions. And this you have to use. So you're basically saying, I'm calling this, is basically what's going on, this.candidate.state, and I'm counting each state. And I'm throwing in the reduce function where I'm going through the state and the value, and I'm starting with a count of zero, and I'm iterating through the length of my, basically the length of all of the states. And as long as there's some, you know, as long as there's something there, I could iterate through it. And then I increment my count, and then I return it. Sorry, maybe I should zoom out just a little bit to help this a little bit. And then what's going on here is you still use the JavaScript variable notation here, but you have to enclose all of your functions with strings. So basically what you need to remember, you use the code, you put the parentheses, you put the quotations, and then whatever your function is on the inside. When you actually call this and you say, I'm going to call my MapReduce, you still use your collection alias, but here, instead of MapReduce being map, reduce is one word, and the R is capitalized, here it's not. It's map underscore reduce, and then you call those in. And what's going on here is I'm storing a file where it's called skills by state, okay? If you were in the Mongo shell, it would look a little bit different. Okay, and let me show you that. So in the Mongo shell, what would happen is where is it at? Is that it? No, that's aggregate. Oh, it's a different example. I'd have to open it up. So let's open that up right here. Okay. So what you're doing is right here, you're calling out. So you're saying this output this data into a file instead of doing it inline, and it prints everything on the screen. And then when you're actually calling it, if you were in the shell, you would do it this way where you're calling that file. But it's a little bit different in Mongo, Pymongo. So here, I can do it two ways. I can say, I'm calling the function that I just created here with the MapReduce, and I do a dot find and iterate through it, and then append it, and this is what it looks like, where I have each state with the number of clients for that state for my recruiter database. And I did this example to say, what if I'm looking for bumping up the number of clients that I have in states that are really poor, like low numbers, okay? So you have to do a sorting here. So I said, all right, let's do a value.count in this sort and find out which states we need to get more people recruited, basically. In this example, what I did is just like the MongoDB version. I did db.skillsbystate, and that's what I called it here, and I did .find, and I sorted it and I iterated through it and it pulled up the same data. Whereas here, I'm only calling it directly. So I'm basically saying db.collectionName, MapReduce, and calling it and running it directly instead of this file that I created. And this file is shown here. If you go into Mongo and you look, we can see right here. Let's see if I can make this bigger. Right there. And that's where it is. So that's the file that's created. And it's actually in your collections. And that's how you're able to call it with the db.find or db.skillsbystate. Okay? So that's some examples that you can use with Pymongo. I would like to say thank you for watching this video, and I hope you like it. If you did not like it, please leave me a comment before you do a thumbs down. And as always, if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.